Today we are discussing about gene cloning, or we can also call it as genetic engineering. Now what is this gene cloning? It is an experimental method through which many copies of or multiple copies of gene are generated. That means we can generate the multiple copies of gene by the help of a process that is known as gene cloning. Say for instance, if we have a cell here, if I make it roughly, say this is a cell here, and this cell is having a nucleus, and within the nucleus we have a presence of DNA. Now this DNA identifies certain gene here, which is a desired gene, or which is a gene of interest you find out on this DNA. Now you want to have a multiple copies of this gene. So if you want to have a multiple copies of this gene, you can go through the process that is gene cloning, and you can make a huge number or huge copies of this gene, or you can create a gene library. But the most important thing is how you can isolate or how you can take this gene out from the DNA. For that, you have to break down the various components of the cell. Like you have to break down the plasma membrane, you have to break down the nuclear membrane. Then after, you have to cut this gene from this DNA. That means you have to cut it at certain position, you have to cut the DNA. So add, you can take out this gene which you want to have multiple copies. So for that, you look at the various, what we call this, enzymes. So we can simply say, we have the tools of gene cloning. That is, for cloning a gene, we require various tools. The tools, first one we have is the enzymes. So we require enzymes, then after we require the most important thing, that is a vector. Then after we require is a host. That means you have taken out the gene now with the help of the enzymes. So we'll see which enzymes we require. After that, you have to put, say for instance, you have taken the vector. Vector may be the plasmid and extra chromosomal DNA which is present inside the bacterial cell. So if you have taken a vector which is a circular molecular DNA, then after you have taken the gene which you have taken it from the DNA, that is the gene of interest, now you can fit it into the vector. Say this you have a vector, and this you have a gene of interest. So you have fitted it into the vector. Now you can call this one as a chimeric DNA. This is known as a chimeric DNA, or you can also call it as recombinant DNA. That is a recombinant DNA. So you have to keep in mind, you have taken out the gene of interest now with the help of the various enzymes. You see all enzymes you require. Then after you have fitted it inside the vector. What is vector? Nothing. Is an extra chromosomal DNA which is isolated from the bacteria. That is known as a plasmid, like plasmid may act as a vector. Now you have fitted the gene of interest inside it. Then after you take the gene, this recombinant DNA or this chimeric DNA, you will put it into the host cell. And within the host cell, it will multiply because the bacteria divides in every 20 minutes, so it will make huge copies. Then after, you have the two copies from one bacteria, then four copies from two bacteria, and it will become a huge copy. Then after, you can isolate this again with the help of the enzyme, the gene of interest, and you can make a huge library of the genes. So for that, we look at the various tools, like we have enzymes, vectors, and the host. We will discuss them all in detail, so that we will understand how this gene cloning takes place. Let's have the first part of it, that is enzymes. So we'll discuss in detail all these tools to understand the complete process of gene cloning. The first one we have is the enzymes. Say for instance, you find out that in case of pancreatic cell, especially in islet of Langerhans, say in islet of Langerhans, we have a presence of gene. That gene is mainly responsible for the synthesis of insulin. You know about it. because insulin production is through the recombinant DNA technology mainly. So if we have an insulin here present, a gene present here which is mainly responsible for insulin formation, so we want to have multiple copies of this gene so that we can put these all copies in a host to generate the insulin. For that we have to isolate this gene. For isolation of this gene or for isolation of this DNA, we have to degrade the various components of the cell, like the components maybe plasma membrane, maybe nuclear membrane, or even though it may be cell wall in certain cases like in plants, like in fungus. So if we will take only the insulin here, so we have to degrade only the plasma membrane and the nuclear membrane. So that we can isolate the DNA first, then after we can see if we have isolated the DNA here. So we have isolated the DNA, then after we can take this gene of interest which we require, which is located here on this piece. So we can take it out from the DNA with the help of the enzyme, then after we put it in the vector. So for that we require different types of the enzyme. Say for instance, if you have find out the gene of interest or the gene which you want to isolate in a plant cell, then which type of enzyme you require first? Say if it is a plant cell, you have to keep in mind. Say if it is a plant cell, then plant cell consists of cell wall. That cell wall is made up of cellulose. Then you require the enzyme is a cellulase. It is also has some pectin material, then you can use the enzyme is a pectinase. Then it also consists of plasma membrane, which is made up of proteins and lipids. Then you require the enzyme is a protease, and we have the lipase. So these are the various enzymes which you require for isolation of DNA in a plant cell, from a plant cell. The next one we have is an animal cell. Animal cell only bear the plasma membrane and nuclear membrane. For that, nuclear membrane and plasma membrane have the same composition made up of proteins and lipids. So you require the enzyme is a protease and lipase. So these are the two enzymes you require for isolation of DNA from animal cell. Then if the cell is a fungal cell, that means you have find the gene of interest in fungal cell, then you have, fungal cell wall, it consists of a cell wall which is made up of chitin. For that you require the enzyme is a chitinase, and then inside the plasma membrane you require the enzyme is a protease. It's on the nuclear membrane as well, so you require the protease and lipase. So these are the various enzymes which you require to isolate the DNA from the cell. If this cell is a bacterial cell, see for instance if this cell is a bacterial cell, then the enzyme you require for that, for the bacterial cell, is only the enzyme is a lysozyme. Because lysozyme degrades the bacterial cell wall. So the lysozyme you require for the isolation of DNA or the gene of interest from the bacterial cell. Now you have isolated the DNA, no problem, with the help of these enzymes. But now you want to cut the gene of interest from the DNA. Say for instance, if this gene is responsible for insulin, so it's a gene which is responsible for insulin formation, so you have to isolate this gene from the DNA. For that, we have the enzyme, we call that one as the endonuclease. The next enzyme which we require to cut the DNA at a restricted site, to have the isolation or to take the gene of interest out from the DNA, we can call that one second enzyme as endonuclease. Endonuclease are also known as, they are also known as molecular scissors. Because they cut the DNA, again the most important point, they cut DNA at a restricted sites. We see what restricted site is. That means they cut the DNA at restricted sites so that you can isolate the gene of interest. That gene of interest may be for the insulin formation, or it may be any other gene which you want to have multiple copies so that you can insert them into the organism to make the production of insulin, or to make the organism the transgenic plants, animals like we have BT, cotton, all these plants, you see, because we have inserted the gene inside the those organisms. So they are acting as a molecular scissors, they cut the DNA at restricted sites. Now actually these endonuclease, they were isolated from E. coli. They were isolated from bacteria, especially from E. coli. Now, this endonucleus were isolated in 1963. The scientists, they found a system within the prokaryotes or within certain strands of bacteria that they call them as a natural defense system. So within the bacteria, the scientists in 1963 find out a natural defense system, which is also known as a host controlled restriction. This can be also called as host controlled restriction. That means the host or the bacteria is controlling or it is restricting the entry of the foreign substance into the cell. So it is acting as a natural defense system. So understand it better. Let's make the bacterial cell. We see which type of the system they have. Natural system they have. Actually, we can also call this natural system which is present inside bacteria as two complex system. Why we call it two complex system? Because it consists of two parts. One we have, say, for instance, one we have is a methylating agent. It will have one part is a methylating agent. And second one it has a nucleus. So that's why we call this one as a two complex system, or is also known as a natural defense system or host control restriction. To better understand it, let's have a bacterial cell. Say for this is a bacterial cell, if I make it roughly. Now within the bacterial cell, we have presence of, say for this, we have a presence of its own DNA. So this is the own DNA of the bacterial cell. Then after we have this natural defense system which is present within the bacteria. So say this is a natural defense system here. It is having a methylating agent, M agent, and it's also having the nucleus. So this is a natural defense system which is present in this bacterial cell. Say for instance, this bacterial cell gets infected by the virus. So this gets infected by the virus. So if the virus infects it, so virus may have DNA or RNA as a genetic material. Now this DNA or RNA, it comes within the cell. When it comes within the cell, now this bacteria may get infected by the virus. But what happened? Now this nucleus, it is acting as a molecular scissor. Say for instance, it cuts, see if it is a DNA here, roughly I'm making, it's a double strand DNA. It's having adenine here, thymine here. So it cuts the DNA between on the sides like adenine, like it will cut it on thymine. So it cuts the DNA at certain sites like adenine site, or it may cut it on the thymine site. So making the fragments of it degrades the DNA. So we can say nucleus is acting as a molecular scissor. It may cut the DNA in between. Say for it may cut the DNA in between the adenine and thymine. So it cuts it, so it gets broken down into the pieces. So it degrades the DNA. But this nucleus may cut its own DNA. That may be the suicidal condition. Say if it cuts its own DNA, say it's having adenine here, say thymine here. Say it may cut its own DNA, say it's having adenine here, thymine here. It may cut its own DNA. So if it cuts its own DNA as well, what will happen? So this may be the suicidal condition for the cell. But to prevent its suicidal condition, what happened? This methylating agent, it adds the methyl either on A or T. It adds the methyl either on A or T. When it adds the methyl, now it doesn't remain an adenine, now it becomes methylated adenine. What happens? When it leads to the methylation of this adenine, now it is not identified by the nucleus. What happens? It gets prevented by the attack of the nucleus. So that is why it prevents its own cell. So as to prevent it from the suicidal condition, this methylating agent prevents it, but it doesn't methylate this, what you call this foreign DNA. What happens? This nucleus, it acts upon this foreign DNA, broken down into the pieces and prevents the cell from the infection. On the basis of that, we call it a two complex system, or we can also call it a natural defense system, or it is known as a host control restriction. The reason is, now this cell do not allows the foreign DNA to come in or foreign DNA to come in. It restricts its entry. That is why we call these enzymes as endonucleus, or we can also call them as a restricted endonucleus. You have to keep in mind. Now the most important thing which we have to discuss about them is why are they... Say for instance, we have to understand what palindrome is. See, if we will take a sequence like we have G, A, A, T, T, C. So this is a 5 prime and this is a 3 prime. And then after we have one more strand here, that is a, we have G, A, A, T, T, C. So this is 5 prime, this is 3 prime. So if we have a DNA sequences or we have a base sequences which read similar from 5 prime to 3 prime on both the strands, 5 prime to 3 prime, 5 prime to 3 prime on both the strands, if they read same, then we can call them as a palindrome. Say for instance, on 5 to 3 prime we have a G, A, A, T, T, C, and same here from 5 to 3 prime we have a G, A, A, T, T, C. So you can call this type of sequence as palindrome. So you have to keep in mind what palindrome is. Palindrome is if we can read the bases on two strands from 5 prime to 3 prime, that's from 5 prime to 3 prime, these bases are similar. And we can call that type of sequence as a palindrome. Say for instance, if the endonuclease cuts the DNA or cuts these bases or two strands on region of G. See, they cut it in between the G and A. If they cut it in between the G and A, what will happen? See, if we have the formation of G is a separate one, then after we have A, A, T, T, C. And this becomes our 5 prime to 3 prime. And this becomes again 5 prime to 3 prime. Similarly, on second strand, it will one become a larger piece and another becomes a smaller piece. It is a smaller piece here. This is a G here and this is your 5 prime, 3 prime. Then rest we have is a larger piece we have. That is a, A, T, T, and a C. Now this becomes the 5 prime to 3 prime. So if we have a cut which is in between G and A on both strands, but on the palindrome, you have to keep in mind, then two strands get cut down into the four pieces. Two becomes the larger pieces and two are the smaller pieces. And if you have this type of cut with by the endonuclease onto the DNA strands, then they form the ends, we call those ends as sticky ends. We call them as sticky ends because they are unequal. We can call them as sticky ends, or they can also call their cos sides. You have to keep in mind. They can be called as sticky ends or they can be called as cos sides. The gene of interest easily fits within these sticky ends. So it is mostly the sticky ends are taken for what? For binding of the insert or finding for binding of gene of interest. The bonds which gets broken down into the formation of sticky ends, the bonds we have first is a phosphodiester bond. It gets broken down between the G and A here, again G and A here. So we have the broken down of phosphodiester bond is broken down here. Then after we have the formation of a small and a large piece, there is also the breaking down of the hydrogen bonds. So if anybody asks you, which bonds are broken down during the formation of sticky ends or during the formation of the cos sides, so you have to keep in mind the phosphodiester bonds as well as the hydrogen bonds. And in a sticky end formation, one piece becomes a larger and another piece becomes a smaller. Say for instance, if we have a next type of palindrome, say we have G, G, G and we have C, C, C. So this is one type of a sequence we have, that is 5 prime to 3 prime. Then on its opposite side, we have, this is actually a palindrome, you have to keep in mind. See, we have here a 5 prime to 3 prime. Then we have here G, 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 and we have C, C, C. So on the both ends, like from 5 dash to 3 dash, on both ends, like 5 dash to 3 dash, but the bases are similar. So on the basis of that, we can call them as a palindrome. So if the endonucleus cuts in between G and C, if it cuts in between G and C, what will be the formation of these ends? Let's see what fragments will be formed. Like we have a G, 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 it will be one fragment. Then we have a C, 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 it will be another fragment. But your capital might be 5 prime to 3rd prime, it will be 5 prime to 3rd prime. Similarly, on the next trend, where the formation of two ends, like it's a C, 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 then after we have a G, 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 and the ends will be 5 prime to 3rd prime, 5 prime to 3rd prime. Now, you will see the equal piece of form here, isn't it? And we can call this type of cut as blunt ends. We say blunt ends. These are blunt ends, or we can also call them as blunt cuts. And you will see which bond gets broken down here. The bond is only broken down between G and C. So the bond which is broken down to form the blunt ends, that is known as only phosphodiester bond. Only phosphodiester bond is broken down in case of blunt end formation or in case of blunt end formation or blunt cut formation. So this is what you call a palindrome. These are the palindromes, and we will see the endonucleus cuts at different regions. If it cuts on this region to form the sticky ends, if it cuts on this region to form the blunt ends. But mostly we use the sticky ends for the binding of the gene of interest. Now, one more thing which we have to keep in mind, which enzyme we look at, that is the alkaline phosphatase. It's one more enzyme which we look at during the process. So one more enzyme which we require is the alkaline phosphatase. Is the alkaline phosphatase. Say for instance, you have taken the vector here. This is a vector here. So it may be plasmid and extra chromosome or DNA. Now you have cut it with the endonuclease. See, this is a restriction, it has cut it. Now it will form a linear DNA here. So it's a linear DNA. So this may be the 5 prime and this may be the 3 prime. On 5 prime, we have a presence of phosphate. On 3rd prime, we have a presence of OH. We have to keep in mind. Now, this piece may again get rejoined. Because we have to fit the gene of interest here, but this piece may get again rejoined to make a circular structure. It may get again rejoined. See, for instance, we have cut it here. Now it may get rejoined. But for that, what we do, we use the enzyme to keep it linear. We use the enzyme that is alkaline phosphatase. Alkaline phosphatase. This alkaline phosphatase, it removes this phosphate. When this phosphate is removed, so this DNA remains linear. It doesn't bind us again. After that, what we do, we are adding the gene of interest here. If we add, it is a 5-2. So we are adding the gene of interest here. When we are adding the gene of interest to make a phosphodiester bond, now it gets rejoined. We can see what happened. It gets rejoined to this piece of DNA. So the enzyme we use, one more we have for binding of the gene of interest, is a ligase. Ligase is helping in binding of this gene of interest or this foreign DNA into this vector. So we can call the enzyme we require is a ligase. Ligase helps in a ligation. Then after we have to add the phosphate here. So we have to again add the phosphate so that it becomes a complete circle. For that we use the enzyme is phosphorylase. Phosphorylase kinase. The enzyme we use for the addition of phosphate. When phosphate gets added, again it will make a circular structure, but it may have an additional DNA. So this is a circular DNA here, again gets formed. But this DNA have now a gene of interest here. I'm making the different sign. So this black one is a gene of interest, and now it becomes a chimeric DNA or recombinant DNA. Chimeric DNA, or we can also call it as a recombinant DNA. So this you have to keep in mind. So alkaline phosphatase we use to remove the phosphate so that if the DNA remains unwinded, so as we can easily fit the gene of interest inside it. Thereafter, we use the ligase for binding of this gene of interest to this DNA. Thereafter, we use the phosphorylase for addition of phosphate so that it again gets binded to each other to make a circular DNA, because circular minimizes the size. If it gets circular formed again, it will minimize the size. It will easily get inside the host cell. It comes easily inside the host cell as compared to the linear one. Now, tomorrow we'll discuss about vectors, but before that we'll discuss a little bit about the nomenclature of the restriction or endonucleases.